That there is power in the wind is not a new discovery. Man's been using the wind for thousands of years. What most people don't realize is how much experimentation has been going on in this century.
Wind energy is nothing new in America. The idea of windmills was brought here by early European settlers and used in many ways to power grinding mills and later to pump water for the steam locomotives that connected New York and San Francisco, and to supply water for farming. During the early 1940s, large wind generators which could provide power to many users were introduced. Towering above Grandpa's Knob near Rutland, Vermont, the Smith Putnam turbine fed electricity to a Vermont utility company. This system was designed to produce up to 1.25 megawatts of electricity. 1 megawatt equals 1,000,000 watts, or enough electricity to light 10,100-watt light bulbs.
But with the advent of cheap fossil fuels, wind power was neglected. Now, with new materials, new techniques, and information age tools, it's a cutting-edge technology once again, creating new industries worldwide.
The annual growth of the global wind turbine industry has for many years been well over 25%, and this level of growth looks set to continue. In 2020, the number of employees in the industry worldwide is expected to grow from 350,000 to 2 million.
The main challenge with wind energy is to ensure a constant and reliable source of energy supply to consumers. And how do we do that when the energy source fluctuates?
Wind is powerful, but intermittent. That's a problem. But here's a little secret. All sources of power are intermittent. There is no power plant, coal, nuclear, or gas, that's available 100% of the time. The electric grid is built with this in mind. A well-functioning coal plant will not be available 44 days of the year. For nuclear, it's 36 days, as well as 39 days for refueling every 17 months or so. Wind power has a failure rate of only 2%, and units rarely go down all at once. Wind is predictable on a scale ranging from hours to days, and winds tend to die off gradually, allowing for grids to adjust. When conventional plants fail, they often fail completely unexpectedly in milliseconds, which is a major challenge for grid operators. This type of failure gave rise to erroneous reports that a power shortage in Texas was once caused by low wind conditions. In fact, an official investigation of the incident showed that unpredicted high demand and the failure of a large conventional unit triggered the short-lived pinch, which did not result in any customers losing power. Global experience has shown that a well-interconnected grid makes outages from any source increasingly unlikely.
A strong and well-developed electricity grid within Denmark and to the neighboring countries transmits energy from the wind turbines out to where consumers are. Denmark is part of a strong electricity market where electricity can be bought and sold, all in all, to accommodate supply and demand and to ensure competitive and fair prices for electricity. A national transmission system operator ensures that the actual generation of electricity and its actual consumption always balance by asking the power stations to step on the brakes or to step on the accelerator or through import and export to neighboring countries.
And energy can be stored as well. A well-known technology is pumped storage, where water pumped uphill during times of low demand is usable during times of high peaks.
By taking energy from the wind and by building large hydroenergy reservoirs, we can make energy from the wind fully reliable and usable. Switching to our own natural energy, Ireland will save huge sums and export power to earn great wealth.
Yet another off-the-shelf technique is using electricity during times of low demand to compress air, which is stored underground. When it's needed, the valves are opened, the air drives turbines, and produces renewable power on demand. Another question about wind turbines is their impact on birds and wildlife. Stories abound about impacts on bird populations. A study by the National Academy of Science helped put the problem in perspective. According to U.S. government research, wind turbines killed 20 to 37,000 birds in 2003, with all but 9,200 of those kills occurring in California. Where does that put wind turbines compared to other hazards that birds face?
There wasn't an awareness about the magnitude of this problem. Reasonable estimates place the mortality between 100 million and a billion native birds dying in North America each year in window collisions.
They hit the glass and they die.
Other hazards to birds include loss of habitat from urban sprawl. Cars may kill 80 million birds per year. Collisions with high tension lines may kill more than a billion birds annually. Habitat destruction from coal mining and fossil fuel production takes a toll. House cats kill hundreds of millions, perhaps billions of birds each year in the U.S. Clearly, bird populations are under stress, but wind turbines are not the primary culprit. A great deal of the mythology around wind and birds comes from one location in California. The Altamont Pass wind array originally included thousands of small, fast-spinning turbines. Proximity to bird habitat made this wind farm particularly deadly. But as obsolete designs are replaced and better siting criteria applied, the problem is easing. With good management, the wind industry may be able to remain a very small contributor to bird mortality, like the less than 0.003% measured in the National Academy study. Many intrepid YouTubers have taken to the field to investigate another charge against wind turbines, that they're noisy.
Just how loud is that? We're f***ing what? 20 metres away, I can't hear f***ing. That's at least a megawatt.
The poster child for the resurgent wind industry is usually Denmark. But there's another emerging player that may change the industry dramatically.
China is looking to be the largest wind turbine, wind power market in the world by the end of this year.
You know, over the last 4 years, we have been seeing doubling of installation capacity every single year. So, you know, in 2005, China had, I think, a cumulative capacity of just about 1.3 gigawatts. Now, in end of 2008, we're talking about 13 gigawatts. I think people were, you know, fully expecting this year may not be doubling again, but you know, at least by 80 or 90% growth. So we're talking about 20, 25 gigawatts by end of 2009. So that's, you know, that's a growth nowhere in the world has experienced previously.
Just 5 years ago, there was really only one Chinese wind turbine manufacturer. Today, we see about 80 wind turbine manufacturers in the Chinese marketplace.
The United States has also experienced explosive growth in wind energy and leads the world in installed capacity. One reason is that the cost of wind power has now become more than competitive with fossil and nuclear power. In fact, the financial letter Bloomberg News recently reported a new phenomenon related to wind power: negative pricing. On windy nights in northern Germany, consumers are paid to keep the lights on. Twice this year, the nation's 21,000 wind turbines pumped out so much power that utilities reduced customer bills for using the surplus electricity. Negative electricity prices happen when we literally don't know where to put it. And we'll see this happen more often in the future. Standing under an open sky, you suddenly realize there is no shortage of energy. We are swimming in energy. We are made of energy. And all we need is the imagination to reach out and tap it.
All along the eastern shore, it's just